it's your girl, DeShonda Carter, but you can call me DC. Thanks so much for tuning in today to my show, When the Blue Comes Off. Sit back, relax, take notes, do what you like, and let's get into it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my very special guest, all the way from the New York City Department of Corrections, none other than the beautiful Antoinette Anderson. What up, Andy?
Hi, thank you for having me.
Oh, you are welcome. You are welcome, guys. Listen, I am so glad that I was able to catch this young lady, because when I tell you she is busy, she is busy. Like, I thought I was busy, but she is busy, and she's a good busy. And when you hear her story, you're going to see just how busy she is. So with no more delay, let's jump into it. So, Auntie, listen.
Yes.
How long have you been with the New York City Department of Corrections?
Oh, 18 years.
Oh, man. So that means you got 2 more years to go.
Yes, 18 years. I started out, I started and ended, basically, my career in AMKC, which is now closed.
Is it?
That was my home. Yes.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah, that was my home. When I started Department of Corrections, I had just left Department of Homeless Services as a fraud investigator. So basically, my job was to, as the homeless families entered the Bronx AU, I was transporting them to overnight. That's a whole process. And when you come into the shelter system, we you come in, you get interviewed, we put you in a temporary home, a temporary housing. If we don't have anything available at that time, we transport you to overnights until we're able to place you. And then you have a 10-day process of investigation where we figure out if you're eligible for emergency housing or not. So I left there. I did that job for 5 years. There were some issues working at the Bronx EAU. As a fraud investigator, I did a little bit of everything. Like, I just was staying overnighting the families to temporary housing, interviewing, referring families to services like domestic violence, ACS, public assistance. I dealt with all those things. In working there, I actually had an incident with a supervisor where he smacked me. And when he smacked me, I was just in shock because I was like, how dare you hit me? And what happened was he reached his hand out and I didn't shake his hand. So because I didn't acknowledge him, he smacked me.
Oh my God. So, I mean, this was this sounds workplace violence in its finest. Like, are you kidding me?
Yeah, that's what happened. And then I told the director at the time, because I was in shock. All I wanted him to do was apologize. So I think it was an issue with a cultural issue, you know, because I'm from America and he was from, I want to say it was Africa. I'm not too sure where he was from, but he was from another country. So in his country, you know, it was disrespectful for women to talk back. And I didn't even say anything. It was just like he reached out his hand, and I was just like, yeah, no, I'm not shaking your hand, because we had an incident. And to do the overnight, I had to have a partner. And I was like, well, it's New Year's Eve. You let my partner go. Why can't I go be with my family and bring in New Year with my family? And he was like, no, you have to stay. So I couldn't perform my duties because I needed a partner. You have one person inside calling the families, and then you have the other person outside loading up the bus and making sure that everybody's on the bus. So when he let my partner go, I couldn't get it done. So my thing was, after the night was done and I brought in a New Year at the shelter, I was like, no, I didn't feel the need to shake your hand. You did nothing. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't protocol. I didn't have to shake your hand. And I guess he took it as disrespect. And I mean, that man smacked me and brought me back to my childhood ages. Yeah. It actually gave me a flashback, because growing up, I have a story. I didn't have the best childhood. My mother had me at 18, I'm the second oldest of five. My mother had my sister at 15 and turned 16 the following day. So growing up with my mom, I was the oldest in the household because my mother, when she had my sister at 15, my grandmother took care of my sister. So I was basically the oldest of the house.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up with my mom, being that she was a young mom, and not to take away from any young mothers out there, but I was born in 1978. I'm a little seasoned in 1978. So, you know, back in the 70s, the era of how children are raised now is a little different from back then. And I was the oldest, like I said, of five. And I have is me and my younger sister, we have the same father, and everybody else had different fathers. But growing up with my mom, she was the type that always needed companionship, I should say. And unfortunately, when you have younger children, just because you need companionship doesn't mean that your companionship is always the best for the children.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up in that household, unfortunately, me and my sister, well, it started out with me first. I was raped by my mother's best friend's son. I want to say when that started, I was around 8. I was around 8 years old. And when I told my mother, her thing was, oh, no, he loves you like a sister. I'm like, mommy, listen, this is not love. Like, he's hurting me, mommy. He's hurting me. And she was just like, no, no, no. He would never do anything like that. So it went, it didn't go anywhere. It happened for about 2 or 3 years until he was arrested for raping someone actually on the roof of the building that I lived in. And then that stopped. But then it continued years later when she met my stepfather, and it was a whole situation with my stepfather because my mother really didn't know him. And once again, companionship. She wanted companionship. She needed a man that she wasn't considering her children. Even though I had an older sister, she always had a male babysit us. So when she married my stepfather, she left us with his mother. And the mother was taking care of one of her grandkids. I want to say I was around 9. My dad was murdered, so we really didn't have nobody to look out for us. It was just me and my sister and my brother at that time. And my stepfather's nephew raped me and my sister, and he basically threatened our lives and told us if we told that he would kill us. You know, we're kids. We don't know no better. And being that I already had a situation with my mom where she decided that no, 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 nobody would ever do anything like that. It was just like it fell on deaf ears.
So with all of these type of situations, mm-hmm. in your past and this horrific workplace violence, is that what led you into law enforcement?
Well, when I started, as I went through the different years of sexual abuse and physical abuse from my stepfather, I wanted to become a judge. So it just so happened the day after my 10th birthday, I was involved in a car accident where I almost died. My spleen erupted. I had internal bleeding. I dislocated my hip. I had to learn how to walk again at the age of 10.
Wow.
Yes. So when the accident happened, at that time, we already had moved out of New York, and we was in Philadelphia. And my stepfather would come out there maybe every 2 weeks, every 3 weeks. And when the car accident happened, I had already was telling the school, like when he would come out, I was afraid to go home. So ACS got involved out there in Pennsylvania. And when the car accident happened, they thought he did it because I just totally disappeared. I was just off the maps because the incident happened in Delaware, and I was in Delaware for a couple of months. I actually wanted to become a judge because I wanted to, I guess in thinking, and my thinking at that early age was try to protect other children that went through the same type of trauma that I had went through. But later on in life, I realized in becoming a judge, I had to defend as well as prosecute the same type of people that I wanted to protect children from. And I can't protect, I can't defend someone that I knowingly knew did these horrific acts that happened to me to another child. So I had to change my goal in life, what my career, I should say. At the age of 12, I was sent, it might have been 11, but I want to say 12. At the age of 12, I was sent back to New York because I was making too much trouble for my mother and her husband, and she chose her husband over her child. So she sent me to New York, back to New York by myself, to live with my grandmother. That was a whole situation in itself. Anywho, by the age of 13, I ended up in foster care because I was just like, I can't do it. I was already traumatized with the physical abuse. Now living with my grandmother and my aunt, well, my aunt had custody of me, but I physically lived with my grandmother. That's where the mental abuse came in. So I ended up in foster care, and the foster care system, ooh, baby, that is a whole beast in itself. You have some foster mothers that is really in the profession of being a foster mother because they want to love children and save children. But then you have some that's just for the money. And it's really hard to place teenage kids, whether it's a male or a female. It's really hard. I'm gonna tell you and claim that I was blessed. And even in the trauma, I was blessed in going into foster care because I could have been put in a group home, but I wasn't. I was put in several foster homes for different reasons. But the majority of it is that growing up in trauma and not being able to channel that pain and that anger, it's kind of hard to get along with other people, right? Because you have to learn how to manage you being a stranger in somebody else's home and having to deal with whatever rules and regulations they want to put on you. And then trying to deal with your own mental state at the age of 13, 14, 15. It's really hard. At 17, I graduated John Jay. Nope, sorry. At 17, I graduated Prospect Heights. And I started John Jay. When I started John Jay, I knew I wanted to be in the criminal justice field. But then I got pregnant and had my first son at 18. And I didn't stop going to school. I just kept going. And then I had my second son at 21. The crazy thing with my second son, I had him on a Wednesday, and Monday I was back in school because finals was up. And I was like, I got to finish this. I'm marching come June, come May. So I was like, listen, kid and all, we in class. So I always knew I wanted to do something in criminal justice. I just couldn't put my foot on it. I had a thought once upon a time to join the military. But the problem with the military is that they wanted me to sign over custody of my children.
Yeah, that happened to me when I contemplated going into the Marines. And that's something I think I spoke about once before, that you have to give your parental rights up, especially if you're not married. And mm-hmm. Yeah, I wasn't doing that. So I'm with you on that.
Yeah, so I didn't do that. So in the midst of, I did graduate at 21 with a bachelor's in criminal justice. And then I applied for all different type of jobs. I applied for ACS. ACS actually called me. They were going to hire me, but that process was really, really long. I also applied for PD, you know, PD and corrections. They run hand and neck and neck on calling people very fast. And, but correction hired me. So that's how I ended up to become a correctional officer. It wasn't like that was my goal in life. I have an uncle that was a correction officer. And, I told him, I was like, oh, I'm in the academy. And he was like, oh, good. I'm going to come and sit outside and laugh at y'all run around, you know, run around the academy. I was like, don't do that. But, yeah, I did not know this was where I was going to end up. When I started DOC, I want to say it was like joining another family. And it really was, because my battalion was big. And you really, coming from a place where I had family, but didn't have family, you know what I'm saying? Going through the foster care system. When you go into the academy, it's like you meet so many other personalities, like some you clash with, some you click with. But dysfunctional as it is, this is my new family. And going into corrections, this is what I felt like. Like when we graduated and we had to do the wheel at the time, when we worked all the tours, we looked out for each other and we babysitted each other's children. So it was a little different than what it is now. But I was leaving every year. I was leaving DOC. I'm still here. You know, it's not easy to relocate to other states. You know, when you work for Department of Corrections in New York, anywhere you go, any other state you go, they will hire you on the spot because you worked on Rikers Island.
Right.
Just because. So even in me looking into going to other states, it's kind of hard when you relocating with young children that are really not school age yet and trying to reestablish yourself in another state. I just couldn't do it. So I ended up staying here and making it work. And I'm here 18 years later.
Now, out of those 18 years, you said you did all of your time in AMKC, right?
Yeah, 15 of them.
15. And then, so in those 15 years, then AMKC closed. So what are you currently doing for the department?
So from the 15 years, AMKC just recently closed this year. Okay. I'm going to say about 3 or 4 months ago, if that long. I was in AMKC the whole time. I want to say it's an experience. Well, honestly, for me, it wasn't much of a difference from working at the shelter system, except for the fact that I was only working with men. In the shelter system, I'm dealing with children and women. I'm dealing with families.
Okay.
You know, your social service side of, I guess you could say law enforcement, because we were fraud investigator. That was my city title, fraud investigator. Then I became... In 2016, I became a delegate. In 2020, I became a board member, the corresponding secretary of the Corrections Officers Benevolent Association.
Okay, go ahead on, board member for the union, taking on the fight. You're taking on fights left and right. You've been fighting all your life. That song is for you. I've been fighting.
All my life, literally.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. You became a delegate. So you were a delegate in AMKC. Now, one thing about AMKC, I've always heard it was one of the best camaraderie jails, but it's also the largest facility on Rikers Island. So it has the most staff being in one place. So being a delegate there, I know it's a big difference being on the board, but do you think that mentally prepared you for the role that you're in? For the role that you're in now as a board member?
Well, yes and no, because as a delegate, you only deal with the members in your facility. As a board member, you deal with the members in the department. So it's magnitude is maybe like 20 to 1 of how many issues you deal with. So let me go back a little bit. As a delegate, you know, as correction officer, even though we're correction officers and we get to go home, it's like we're doing a bit as well.
Right.
We're doing overtime. We're staying there. So our family in the jails is our work family. And then we have our home family because we're with the jail family, our work family, more than we're with our home family.
Right.
You know, so it's a little different. But what I decided to do in my time at AMKC, I was talking to our officer and they was like, listen, I'm going to teach. But I knew I couldn't deal with the kids because I was like, I can't do that. I can't do the kids all day. No, I can't do that. So I was like, you know what? I want to teach college. So then someone was like, listen, all you need is your master's. I was like, you know what? I'm going to do that. So I ended up going back to school 15 years later to get another bachelor's. So I ended up getting to get my feet wet because the master's, oh, baby, is a whole different world. And it was no way of being out of school for 15 years thinking I was going to get a master's. It was just no way. So I went back to school and I got a second bachelor's degree in criminology. And I wish somebody would have told me to pick something else because criminology was a lot of sociology classes and I just wasn't ready for it, but I did it. And I also had a minor in correctional studies. In which I found out that even though John Jay is the school for law enforcement, the professors that they have at John Jay are not really from the correction world. Like, none of the professors ever worked on Rikers Island. They're from, like, state corrections, fed corrections, but nothing like Rikers Island. Rikers Island is a world in its own.
Right.
So I found myself a lot of times very argumentative with other students in a classroom because it's like, you guys have no idea what we go through at work. You know what I'm saying? Like experiences. And for people to tell stories about correctional officers really made me mad because it's like, y'all just judge us off the bad things they're put in the media all the time. You know, like any law enforcement, we judge them from what we are told about them. But you'll never know what they really go through unless you walk in those shoes.
Right.
So it was a different field. Then I graduated and I went on to my master's and I did all of this while working on Rikers Island. My second bachelor's degree and my master's on Rikers Island. While working at Rikers, I would work at night and I would go to school during the day.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, so is the master's degree your last degree?
That's my last degree achieved. So I got my master's. I also received advanced certificate in correctional studies and advanced certificate in victimology and an advanced certificate in, that's another one. I can't remember what it was.
That's because you got so many, girl. You know? It's like, listen, I mastered that. I'm advanced in that. I'm a master that. Listen, I got it. So with that being said, you did all of these studies. The point to what I'm taking, my takeaway from this is going to be this. I want people to understand what she's saying. There are no excuses, right? She's a mother. She was going to school. She was working in what they call the toughest jails in America, right? And she was doing this day in, day out, and achieved not one degree, but two. So, ladies and gentlemen, please understand, stop making excuses. Do what you need to do for yourself to get yourself in a better position for later on in life, especially if you work for a New York City agency and you can retire early and you've started early. That means you'll be in your 40s when you retire. So you need to be able to be marketable for something else to do if entrepreneurship isn't for you. And even if entrepreneurship is for you, you still need to have some type of education to move forward. With that, I will digress. Now, Board, you went in, you got this master's degree. You said, you know what? I was a delegate, but something made you go from delegate to board member. What was it?
Well, it was election time, and I felt like the people needed somebody to fight for them. And listen, my background I already explained. I've been fighting all my life. So right. One more fight is not going to take me out. Oh. So we ran and I won my position. And I will say that it's not what I expected it to be. It is definitely a challenge every day. It's a challenge because, you know, the board, anybody in this position, it's really hard when we can't get certain things done. You know, like sometimes we feel defeated if we can't win a case or we can't help an officer the way we want to help them. Right. At the end of the day, I am a woman, but I'm still a correction officer at heart. At the end of the day, that's what I am, a correction officer. And I am currently working on my PhD. And it was the officer, her name is Miss Gutter, and she used to work in a corridor in AMKC, and I would walk past her, and I would be like, Miss Gutter, I want to be like you when I grow up. And now I'm in route of achieving that. I'm in route of achieving my PhD, and I'm going to tell you, ooh, nobody warned me. This is a whole different playing field when you're working on your PhD. And I'm doing it strictly online because I received all my degrees through John Jay College of Criminal Justice, but I just could not give John Jay 7 years of my life full time to achieve the PhD program. So I'm actually going to North Central University online. Mm-hmm. It gets challenging at times because it's just like it's not enough hours in a day to work and go to school and be a grandmother, be a mother. It's a lot.
Be a friend. We're getting ready to call you doctor in a little bit. That's what you're trying to tell me?
Yes.
We're going to be calling you Dr. Anderson. All right. That's what I'm talking about. And because, again, it leads me back. You still have 2 years worth of work. So it's not like you sitting on a B post studying all day or you sitting on an A post studying and you got downtime. You out there in the field dealing with crises from officers, going to different meetings, different conferences to better educate yourself, to bring back things to the department. So you're constantly busy, right?
Yeah.
And yet you still find the time to pursue a PhD degree.
Yes. Because my goal is when I leave DOC, whether it's 2 years or 6 years, whenever I decide to, you know, bow down to DOC and say goodbye, I want to be able to do something that I enjoy. And I enjoy telling people our fight, and I enjoy teaching the right thing, because once again, in my school years in John Jay, a lot of schools really don't have correction officers as professors. And I feel like, who can tell our story better than us?
I totally, totally agree. And because you're still active, we really can't get into all the nitty gritty stuff. So when you retire, I'm going to bring you back because we're going to come back and we're going to talk about the stuff, the nitty gritty stuff that we can't talk about right now. But because you got so much going on, I don't want it to overshadow the other stuff that you have going on. And I don't want them to know that until we come back. But before we take this break, I want to say and ask you, actually, all of the things that happened in your younger life and that led you down the path where you are, and you seem to be filled with passion about it, and I'm not going to make an assumption, so I want to hear it from you. Do you ever regret taking this position on in terms of a correction officer? Or if you had to do it again, would you have gone? Do you think you would have went another route, knowing what you know now about the Department of Corrections and the line of work that it is?
I'm going to be honest with you. Being a correction officer is a different world. I don't think I would have taken any other route but to do this. I love what I do. And you know, even though sometimes the media and, you know, we have other people that love us so much, they portray us as like we want to go to work and just beat up on the incarcerated individuals. That's not the case. It's a whole different world in here. And I just wish that when things are done or things happen, that they really look at the whole picture and stop blaming us. It's like we're the scapegoat all the time.
Right. Agreed.
And that's the only thing I would change is the perception of us. We're law enforcement. We're the forgotten law enforcement because, you know, everybody forgets about correctional officers. You know, we're jail guards. We're not respected in our jobs. We're not respected in our titles. And I just feel like, respect us. We took a test. We're civil servant. We're officers. Respect us.
I totally agree. And I love how you say that. Respect us. Yeah. Yes. Respect us. My authority. Damn it.
Yes. Respect my title.
That's
I'm a
right.
correct officer. I work in the top, the boat. I'm bold. We're the boldest. That's who we are. We are the boldest.
Right.
And we work off the streets of New York. We do. We really do. To be confined in these areas and still have to come to work with a smile on our face. Well, some of us, you know, have smiles on our face. And to endure, you know, the stresses of work. Everybody, every job has some sort of stress. So I'm not going to sit here and say that to become a correction is the worst thing. No, it is one of the best experiences that you can have. Now, we do have some rough days, but listen, it's an experience. And just like any other job, this job may not be for everybody, but I'm going to tell you, this job is for me. If I could work in the shelter system, I could work in the jail system.
Oh, I love that. This job is not for everybody, but this job is for me. That's what I'm talking about, because everybody can do it. But ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break and we're going to come back. And listen, she just told you all these things that she's accomplished thus far while still having 2 years to go. Wait until we come back and I could tell you some more stuff that she got going on. So stick around and we'll be back in about 2 minutes. Hey guys, have you ever thought about having a career in the financial industry? Neither did I, but guess what? It's possible. So why don't you DM me, email me, or call me to set up an appointment to see if it's something that you possibly may be interested in. You never know until you try. Hope to talk to you soon. And make sure if you don't have life insurance, time to get you some. Welcome back, guys. I'm here with none other than the amazing Antoinette Anderson, New York City doctor. Look, I'm already calling you a doctor, girl. New York City Department of Correction Officer. Soon to be called Dr. Anderson, okay? We're going to finish telling you what she does. Now, she is currently still in her blue. She has not yet retired, but she is doing amazing things. Now, this one of these next projects I want to talk on is you've not only added entrepreneur to your accomplishments, but you've also are known as an author, an award-winning author at that, in an anthology of this phenomenal book called Uncuffed Voices. Tell the people about that. How did you get involved in that project?
So I met Chanel. Well, actually, I met Karen, and Karen introduced me to Chanel. And Chanel was doing this book, and I was like, I want in. So this is one of the things that a lot of people, well, correction officers know, but maybe not a lot of the public. I'm one of the three women of COBA that is fighting for some things to be changed. And one of the bills that we have is for sexual assault to become a felony. Right now it's a misdemeanor. It's for sexual harassment to become a misdemeanor, and right now it's a violation.
Is that within the department you're talking about, like in workplace violence?
No, in Albany.
Okay, so
the school. Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't affect just law enforcement. It's just the everything in total for anyone, or is it just for corrections?
It's for law enforcement. We're talking about law enforcement, so okay. Correction, police department. But this is the issue. Unfortunately, with the laws, have not changed with the times. So, with all the things that, you know, we are enduring in our workplace, that's one of the bills, two of the bills that we're working on that we need to be passed because of some things that's going on that needs to be stopped. So in working on these bills and trying to get these bills passed, we, the three women of COBA, we've been interviewing with different council members and senators, trying to, you know, trying to get them to understand why we need these bills passed. In Venetia now, when the three women of COBRA are conducting these interviews, my portion of the interview is basically alerting people that, listen, as a victim of sexual assault, working in certain workplaces, you know, it can affect me in different ways. Now, I came forward with my story because if my goal is to help people, how can I help them if I don't let them know some of the experience that I went through, to let them know, listen, I've been there. We can overcome this. Not everybody that's been sexually assaulted and abused at an early age can handle things the way I handle it. You know, everybody deals with trauma differently. In working with Chanel, and my chapter is about trauma and law enforcement. So even though I went through these things in early in life, before I could even know what was really going on with my body, with my mind, with my emotions, why I felt certain ways, because I was a child when these traumas were introduced to my life, and not really getting any type of therapy until I entered the foster care system, which caused its own set of traumas, you know, on me. I needed to tell my story. So in working with Chanel, is 18 of us in the book Uncuffed Voices, and only two of us, which is myself and Abigail, are correction officers. Everyone else is some sort of PD in different states. I don't think anybody from the book is in New York besides me and Abigail, but we're correction officers. And I felt like a lot of people, when they tell their stories, is police department. I felt that correction officers needed to be included because we have stories as well. And not just like a law enforcement thing, but this particular book is about law enforcement and how we deal with different things. And I spoke about the foster care system. I spoke about a few things. But overall, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Not everybody that goes through childhood trauma, whether it's sexually or mentally, or even growing up in domestic violence situations like I did with my mom in that household, there was a lot of domestic violence in the home that I grew up in, turns out having to inflict trauma on their own kid, or not coming out of that trauma and turn to drugs or alcohol. How I dealt with my trauma, I turned to books. When I get upset, when I get frustrated, I pick up a book, because I lose myself, all that frustration and anger, I put in those papers and get those A's and get those B's. Mm-hmm. I try to stay away from those, but A's and B's. But, you know, I'm not going to lie. Statistics was a little bit of a challenge. You know, when the math is not just math. It's research, and is different. It's a research method. There's a whole lot of different things with statistics. But for the most part, I just challenge, you know, channel my frustrations into my schoolwork. So that's how I was able to do it. It can be challenging in dealing with things. And then, you know, children are challenging in themselves. And now I'm a mother of three, a grandmother of four, and I'm currently a foster parent as well. So I have a lot of challenges in my adult life as well as trying to help others. But it all came from, I don't think that I would be able to do the things that I do if I didn't go through those things that I went through as a child. God has blessed me in many different ways. And even though I went through the fire, look what I'm turning out to be. And that's all by the grace of God.
Amen. Amen. So even with Chanel Dickerson, I know because I've had her on the show as well, and I've had a couple of your other co-authors on the show as well. Now, you said your chapter is 18, and you wrote it about the
Trump. No, chapter one. There's 18 of us. I'm chapter one.
Oh, my bad. There's 18 of you. You're chapter one. So in your chapter, yeah. It's almost like, oh, my God, you turn to chapter one. You're like, oh, shit. This is wow. You know what I mean? Because people don't think that correction officers, law enforcement really have feelings. Like, they just think that you put on a uniform, you go to work, everything in your home is peachy keen, and you're going out into the street to fight crime, and you're a big bully and stuff like that, not realizing the inner strength that you have to have because of everything that's going on in your own personal life. They dehumanize us in so many words. Yeah. And this book kind of, because I don't want to give it away. I mean, the book is out now, guys. So make sure you guys get the book. Where can the people get the book from you?
So we are, you can reach out to me at ourthronellc@gmail.com. And you can reach out to either myself or Abigail Raymond. And we'll reach out. We'll tell you how to purchase the book from us.
Okay. So when you guys get the book, we're going to reiterate that part. You get the book from these ladies here. You're going to read and see that out of these 18 chapters and 18 women involved in this project, how diversified yet similar the stories all turn out. So make sure you guys go get Uncuffed Voices. Now, her email address is Our Thrones, right?
Our Throne. @gmail.com.
Now, the reason why I mentioned the Our Throne is because not only, and this is what I was telling you, I told you that she does a lot of stuff. Like, she's putting me to shame here. She's like, not only is she an author, but now her co-author, Abigail Raymond, who is also a New York City Department of Correction officer, right? They partnered up and created this business called Our Throne. So tell the people what that consists of.
So Abigail and I, we became partners, and we was like, okay, let's do something together, because now, you know, we're co-authors in this book. Let's see where else we can go. Let's do clothing. Let's do consulting. You know, we're two businesswomen, like mind like women, and we was like, you know what? Corrections is not the end. When we end our journey with corrections, we want to be more than just a retiree. You know, we want to do something. I don't want to just leave corrections and go do security at an AT&T store. I want to do something that I am my own boss. So we created Our Throne, and we want to do a clothing line. We want to, you know, it's so many things that we want to do. I can't, like, list them all at once right now.
Okay.
I'll have to go until, like, 2 o'clock in the morning. But we are very outgoing women, and we're just, it's not too many black women that could come together and make something work.
And that's important. That's important, right? The camaraderie of women in general. I mean, it would be idealistic if all women, right, could get together and be on one accord. But before you can reach out to all, we need to start in with our group of people. And it is important that black women support each other, right?
Yes.
And you know what? With the trauma, what you're saying, and I think that comes from our community in a whole, right? We have a lot of trauma. We go through a lot of domestic violence. We go through a lot of emotional abuse, psychological abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse. And these things are not openly talked about enough. So when we go to work and, you know, our husband just raped us, because, you know, they don't consider that rape. Because if you tell your husband no, it's still no.
Uh-huh.
You know, but I come to work every day telling this man to get off of me because I don't want to. But he's telling me, no, you're my wife. You're going to give it to me. And if you don't give it to me, I'm going to take it. Right? So imagine going to work in an environment where there's nothing but men. and you're being physically and psychologically abused every day by a man.
Yeah, so part of us fighting for the laws to be changed is that right there. Everybody is, okay, so when you talk about trauma, everybody doesn't deal with trauma in the same fashion, right? So here I am, I can vocalize years, and I mean years, years of therapy and years of finding different ways to challenge that anger. And hatred is a strong word, but at one point it was hatred for these men that violated me. You know, I can remember, and even as a child, I used to just put things on the back burner, just wished it away until I forgot about it. And it was something that was done to me as a child that here and there it comes back to haunt me every now and then. But my stepfather, when he I was trying to get my mother's attention, you know, and I was misbehaving. I can honestly say I was, to get her attention, because this man just had my mother, I don't know, like under a trance. Like she forgot that she had kids. And she left me in the house with him one day, and I woke up with a gun to my face. And he was like, oh, you think, because I had ran away, you think that you're going to get rid of me? No, I'll kill you before you get rid of me. And all I could do is lay there and just cry. I had to have been about 7. I want to say I was about eight. A lot of this trauma happened before I was 10 years old. So, you know, I'm able to put it to the side, but at some point it does haunt me here and there. So he had a gun to my head, pulling the trigger. You know, I'm a kid. I don't know no better. It was a shotgun, so I didn't know it was empty. I just thought this man gonna kill me. And eventually he stopped after I wet the bed. And my mother finally came in the house, and I went to go tell her, like, Mommy, put a gun to my head. And, you know, as a child, we don't know how to cry and not make noise. So now I'm trying to get myself together where he can't hear me. And I'm telling Mommy, he put a gun to my head. And she's like, no, he would never do nothing like that. And he heard me. He's like, yeah, I did it, and I'll do it to you, too. You know, it's just certain things that we go through as a child, and when we become an adult, it's just like, I lived through that, and I'm still here. So God had plans for me. Because through a car accident where I almost died, this man, that gun could have went off and killed me, but I'm still here. And when we talk about trauma, when I got pregnant with my first son, I was afraid to have a girl. Because I thought, oh my God, I'm going to be like my mother. I'm not going to be able to protect my daughter. Mm. And for nothing, that, through all three of my pregnancies, was my thought. Like, I do not want a girl. God, please. Don't let me have a girl. I want to be able to protect my children, not knowing that, you know, those type of things happen to boys too. It doesn't have to just be a girl.
Right.
But, you know, so it does. Childhood trauma does leave a long lasting impression on you, even through therapy and growing up. And so now, as an adult, it's like, listen, I'm not putting up with none of this crap. Like, I'm not into domestic situations, because my thing is, if we get into a domestic situation, then we don't need to be together, because I'm not going to be waiting for you to go to sleep. No, I'm not. No, like, I don't want to. That's not how I wanted to live, because I had to live like that as a child. So as an adult, I never wanted to relive that type of trauma. So even with fighting for custody for my granddaughter, that I'm her foster parent. Listen, things in life happen, and once again, going through the foster care system, I just couldn't let her go into the foster care system. I mean, I couldn't let her be with strangers, because not everybody's intentions is the best for children.
Right.
And even though I came into the foster care, being a foster parent for my granddaughter, I told the agency if they had somebody her age, I would take them. But a lot of these children that come into the system, they do end up with people that cause trauma on them as well. And it's not good. It's not a good thing, because we're raising these children. These children are being raised. They were removed from trauma situations, and your job as a foster parent is to give that child a safe haven. So in working in the Department of Corrections, even though people get caught up in situations, they end up on Rikers Island, and not everybody that's there should be there, but at the end of the day, when they get released, they're coming back into the communities. So they need to be, they need trades. It makes no sense, because the majority of the population that's housed on Rikers Island is Black and brown. And yes, they may have committed a crime. Yes, they may be fighting for their freedom, but they need to be conditioned so when they come out, they can function on their own and not turn back to a life of crime. They need to be able to function.
I agree with that in so many ways. But again, I know by you still working, we're not going to really elaborate on it. But I feel like even in school, the school systems, right? New York City education, Department of Education. I remember when I was in school, just regular school, junior high school, we had shop classes, right? So they had economics. They had home health classes. They don't do any of that. They don't do any of these things anymore. They just teach, in my opinion, you've been schooling, having school way more than me, but but back in my day, right? I feel like the trade schools are what's needed, right? Because if they start them in school to give them a trade, it shouldn't take them to have to be incarcerated to learn a trade. You know what I mean? So if you give somebody something to do and make them proactive, then when they get to jail, they don't have to be reactive. Right. You know what I mean? So
let's talk about the school system. It's crazy because when I put my granddaughter, when I registered for her for first grade, the school that I registered her in was a public school. The first 2 weeks, they gave them no homework. They gave them no type of homework. I was in the process of transferring her to a charter school. Yeah, it's a totally different world, because when I finally got her, she started the charter school 2 weeks late. No, I want to say it was a month later, because the charter schools at that time, they didn't do it this year. They start 2 weeks earlier than a regular school year. So they started like the end of August. All that work from the first day of school for them up until the day that she started the school, she had to make all that work out. So I feel like the education system is not doing our children justice, because if I wasn't able to get her into the charter school, then she would have been behind.
Right.
And I kind of feel like the education system, like they had with COVID happened, a lot of the kids fell behind because they weren't in a classroom setting. A lot of the kids were not used to being on a computer and having to stay still in one chair and not move around and not interact with their friends. So it kind of set them back a little. These kids need things that keep them focused. Like my granddaughter she loves math, so she pays attention to math, but other things she don't pay attention to. So it's like with the younger kids, we need to find another way to keep their attention. Now when you get to high school, like my son, he's 16 in high school, that's a whole different generation, because these kids, it's like nothing that you give them keeps them focused on it. It's like they don't want to do this, they just want to hurry up and graduate, but they need to learn something. I think what's different now from when I went to school, so many years ago, of high school, and what they're doing now with the children, they don't have textbooks. That's a problem. How are they supposed to learn? Everything can't be, you know, a lot of the things keeping them glued to a phone or to a computer. No.
They need a
physical book. And I just feel like now in the times that we're in, they should teach them about stocks. I never learned that in school. that's something that, you know, we might, some people can benefit from. You should teach them how to finance money, like the certain things, trades, desk, barbershop. Any, not everybody could be a barber. You know, some people, you walk around, you see, that's not a trade for everybody. You know, that's not for everybody.
Right.
Beauty school. Like, in school, cosmetic. Why are they not doing cosmetic? Why are they not teaching kids how to hem? You know, it's just some things that we learned when we was in high school that they, I feel like, should be fundamentals to the children. And it's some things that the education system needs to change with the time.
Well, like, I believe... You will be the one to implement all of the change between fighting for bills, fighting the administrations. Like I said, I'm going to have to find a name for you, because every time I see you, that's all I'm going to say from now on is all my life. Like, I had to fight. I'm not going to even say nothing else. That's just going to be how I greet you all my life. I had to fight, whatever. I forget who sang the song, you know, but you know who I'm talking about. But the long and the short story is, everybody, this amazing woman has accomplished so much, and she's still thriving, and she's just still learning, and she's still growing. So you can too. No excuses. She's an author. She's working on her PhD. She's fighting Congress for bills to protect women in law enforcement. Okay? There is nothing... Not still an active mother, not just to kids, little kids, but to teenage too. She has teenage children, so you know that's a lot involved. So, guys, pick up a book, take a class, do not let your brain go idle. Constantly learn. Now, before we go, anything you want to say to anyone regarding, hey, you know, I saw that you was in law enforcement. I see that you're in law enforcement. I'm thinking about coming onto this job. And that's kind of a great question for you, because you are, you do sit on the board of the Correctional Officers Benevolent Association. Mm-hmm. What would your response be to a person that's coming on, and what words of encouragement would you give them?
Ooh, that was a lot. Okay. First off, this is a great job. It has, and like any other job, we have our ups and we have our downs. So I think in law enforcement, you know, you have PD, you have us, you have the fire department. You have so many other options. But if you're coming to join a family and work together and meet new friends, this is it. We learn from each other. We help each other. It's a brotherhood, a sisterhood. This is it. We need you. You want to come on? Come on. We need you. Come on by. Take the test, please.
Ain't nothing to it but to do it, huh?
That's it. Listen, like I did. My grandmother she used to be a court officer, so she would always tell me, listen, take all these exams. Her thing was, take a city exam. Get into the union. Get you a unionized job. You need stability. You need to make sure that you have a job that's going to have your back, because the private sector and working for the city is two different entities. Mm-hmm. You could work for the bank and they'd be like, okay, you fired. Everybody laid off. There's nothing that you can, at least with a city job, you have some right. So I'm telling you, come on, take this job. It's not all that people say, but we do have our trying days as any job. So it's not like, is outrageous, but don't always believe what people say, what they portray about us, because we are mothers, we are grandmothers, aunts, uncles, wives, we have husbands, we have, you know, you have the men on the job. It's a job like any other job. Come to work, do your job, take pride in your uniform, and you'll be fine.
I love it. Now, where can the people follow you on social media? Because they need to know where they can get your merchandise. They need to know where they can get your book. What's your social media handles?
So, on Instagram is NETTE_ANDY. On Facebook is Antoinette Anderson.
And any last shout out you want to give to anybody else?
Well, I want to thank my family for putting up with me, because, you know, I'm a handful at home. My 16-year-old son be like, Mommy, can you just go to sleep? You're doing too much. I have a 23-year-old in college. He's like, Mom, can you sit down and let me get some degrees? I'm like, listen, young blood, you better catch up. You know, all my support, you know, because not for nothing, when you join any type of law enforcement job, you have to have a support team. And I'm honestly say, when I started this job, I didn't have much of a support team, but I did have some support. Their godfathers, their godfather mother, the other grandparents, you know, they did help out. But I'm going to tell you, this job has its ups and downs, but in the long run, it's a good choice. Stability.
There it is. And wait, before we go, there's a last statement, because I think we'll both get in trouble if we do not shout out the women in corrections.
Yes, that's my family as well. They're my support as well. Yes, the women in corrections. Women in corrections, they're here to help the women, the civilians, as well as the officers that work on Rikers Island in the correction system. Yes, they are here. Become a member, because most of the staff on Rikers, there's more women than men, and every woman, every correction officer, as well as civilian staff, should be a member. They help out. They're doing raffle right now to help out families.
For Thanksgiving.
They're working on amazing things, and I'm part of them as well. So let me tell you, I'm a woman of many trades. I'm the jack of many trades, and I want to shout out to the women of gas, the women of corrections. That is my other family as well.
See, I'm telling you, because they wasn't going to come for me. You know, it wasn't going to come for me. I said, listen, make sure we going to shout them out, because they was not going to be like, how they going to have an interview, talk about corrections, and both of them sit on the board, and neither one of them mentioned the women in corrections. So we definitely got to shout out the women in corrections.
They got out there. They got out as well. And I want to thank all my correction officers, because you guys are my brothers and my sisters. And at the end of the day, whether I'm on this board or not, I'm a correction officer at heart. That's my job, to be here for you guys.
Well, guys, thank you so much for listening and being a part of this amazing interview. Make sure you get her book and make sure you follow her on all of her social media platforms, so that way you don't miss a beat, because this woman sounds like she's just going to keep going and going like the Energizer Bunny. And I'm afraid if you're not following, you're going to blink and miss the next activity. So again, soon to be Dr. Anderson, because I'm claiming it for you.
I'm claiming it.
Thank you so much for being on When the Blue Comes Off. And then again, once your blue does finally come off, we will revisit and talk about some of the, you know, some of the things that we can't talk about right now. So guys, all right, guys, we'll take it easy, and we'll see you next time on When the Blue Comes Off. I hope you guys enjoyed the show, and I look forward to bringing you many more, all with positive vibes. Remember, whatever you do, do it from the heart, with love and passion. Stay safe. Talk to you soon.